بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، والصلاة والسلام على حبيبنا ومعلمنا وقدوتنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. إن شاء الله اليوم هنبدأ نكمل موضوع الذئبة الحمراء وأمراض الكلى، أو الذئبة الحمراء وعلاقتها بالكلى. Today هنتكلم عن الموضوع، عن التركات المهمة والكلينيكال بيرل اند كومون ميستيكس ان مانجمنت اوف سيستميك لوبس اريثيماتوزس اند ريليتد لوبس نفرايتس ويز ذيس ديزيز. I will go to the most clinical point today. We'll go ahead. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. صدق الله العظيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وكل اعملوا فسيرى الله عملكم ورسوله المؤمنون. صدق الله العظيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. صدق الله العظيم. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا ومعلمنا وقدوتنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اليوم هنبدا على طول بالكلينيكال كيسز، لان معانا محاضره طويله اليوم، وان شاء الله تستمتعوا بيها وتطلعوا بافاده ان شاء الله ليكم ولمرضانا باذن الله. اول كيس عندنا 36 years female patient seen for AKI just consultation just the GI team or rheumatology team consult nephrology for AKI with dark colored urine like cola urine for 2 weeks with past medical history of SLE. مريضة عندها الذئبة الحمراء من 5 سنين وعندها history of miscarriage and new hypertension. عندنا about 2 or 3 miscarriage before and new hypertension with this dark color urine with AKI with history of miscarriage and systemic lupus and the history also of alcoholic abuse intermittent and also tobacco smoking and no other drug abuse. Family history, mother with SLE, her mother with SLE and lupus nephritis before. Family history is positive for her. Not allergic to any drugs or foods. Medications, she is in ciprofloxacin 500 BID. That's for UTI and amlodipine 5 milligram. Black meal already hydroxychloroquine 200 BID. Ibuprofen from this ibuprofen 600 milligram for 6 hours for arthralgia. Acetaminophen also. Review other system, she's complaining of fatigue, nausea, emesis. Most the patient came by nausea and vomiting, generalized fatigue, dark urine, arthralgia also. So it's taking ibuprofen and paracetamol. When the exam is a little bit hypertensive, you know, hypertension, AKI, dark cola urine, picture of nephritis here. And febrile will appearing college age woman abnormal data in an examination. There's no peripheral edema being abdominal exam benign also. Abdominal exam soft legs, several tattoo, but no skin lesion. Hair blood work in summary serum creatinine AKI from baseline 0.8 normal to 2.6, albumin 2.5 from 3 as a baseline. Hemoglobin 10 from my anemia also 10 from 12.5 gram per deciliter. N is highly positive, C3 and C4 is low, anti double strand also is high, anti Smith, anti Ro antila also positive, NK, hepatitis, and HIV all negative. For analysis, show specific gravity is 1011, and pH is 6, plus 4 protein. Plus four blood is active, active urine here or active urine sediment, and thin white blood cells, trace leukocytes and the thin white blood cells, more than 200 red blood cells, positive red blood cell cast. This is active urine sediment. Now we are dealing with picture of proliferative something. We'll come to that. The urine protein creatinine ratio 4.5 gram. Urine protein already 4.5 gram. We have nephrotic range proteinuria also with this active urine sediment. Urine analysis at time of diagnosis of systemic lupus was planned and no proteinuria. The kidney biopsy shows this proteinaceous material of mesangial matrix expansion, little bit proliferation of the cell inside the capillary. This clear here, just vital cell proliferation or Bowman's space here away from the capillaries. Capillary inside this proteinaceous material, mesangial expansion here, and also cell proliferation. Mesangial picture of mesangial proliferative, but we are seeing here this cellular like cellular start to be forming cellular crescent here with this proteinaceous material. This cellular crescent also we can see here. This is a picture of tubules and the interstitium with this interstitial inflammation, all this interstitial inflammatory cells. Okay, that's this picture of interstitial inflammation also. And this picture also of mesangial. Mesangial expansion here. This is a mesangial here. And this also picture of immunofluorescence with IgM deposition here under immunofluorescence. And this IgG is a granular form of immunoglobulin deposition here in immunofluorescence in our glomeruli, as we see here. And electron microscope, this is a capillary, and this capillary is a glomerular basement membrane, and this already is mesangial here, mesangial deposition and expansion here. Also mesangial here, mesangial expansion here also we can see, and this is a capillary, and this red blood cells here inside the capillary. But these are the glomerular basement membrane here, thickness is okay. And no epithelial or subendothelial deposition. Just only mesangial here, mesangial deposition clear here. Patient treated with sodium hydroluminescence. This active finding, you will see this patient with active urine sediment, nephrotic angiopoietinuria, the history of systemic lupus. Already this patient positive for systemic lupus and all immunological marker is increased. Your patient, you are dealing with active patient. Now you should start IV sodium hydroxide or pulse steroid, methylprednisone for 3 days. You can give 1 gram first day or 500 milligram daily for 3 days. And we'll continue. And we'll continue prednisone 1 milligram per kg, maximum 80. Another schools since a long time, INH regime, will start your patient on IV cyclophosphamide 0.5 or 1 gram per meter square monthly for 6 months. But all this trend changed now. This all the case already. But this trend changed MF now as a first line therapy, even with patient with active lupus as this patient. This patient came for me now. Anywhere, I will start this methylprednisone sodium hydroxide first. We'll give 1 gram first dose, maybe 500 in frequent 2 doses. Then I will continue prednisone 1 milligram per kg, maximum 80. And I will start second line MMF. If my patient is stable, I will start MMF. Or my Fortic MMF is 500 BID or 250 BID and titrate up to reach 1 gram or 1.5 gram BID. If we will give my Fortic, I will start my patient 180 BID, 360 BID, then reach 720 BID. And if the patient, everything is stable and the creatinine is stabilized because this is AKI, I will delay RAS now, ACE or ARBIS. We have telmisartan, we have candesartan, we have ramipril, prendopril. We can use this, but after stabilize here, acute kidney injury now, we'll delay this line now. The most important line now is steroid. Steroid able to suppress or control your disease now, and I will add the second agent, this mycophenolate, not cyclophosphamide now. It's in all the, we are using this by cyclophosphamide, and we'll come to this in the first mistake in our mistakes we spoke later in our presentation today. Discuss fertility because the patient already given cyclophosphamide at that time. Discuss the fertility risk. Patient was not planning for any children in future. And already received, started the cyclophosphamide. Bactrim already started as a BG prophylaxis for here. This is a maintenance therapy also as MMF after this cyclophosphamide. And to continue RAS after stabilize her kidney function and destroy tapering and then off after maybe at least 6 weeks, 6 months to 12 months. This patient, when she came, just came by acute kidney injury, creatinine 2.5. And here already started rise here to 3.8. Started already IV cyclophosphamide, just started steroid here. They started the initial patient started the cyclophosphamide creatinine trending GABA and the proteinuria. This is the urine, this is the urine protein creat ratio, and this is the serum creatinine. All trended up after that 7 weeks from after 7 weeks from the therapy, just everything started to be settled down. After follow-up, with the follow-up, the proteinuria coming down and the creatinine also coming down after this treatment by pulse steroid, maintenance steroid, and the IV cyclophosphamide and continue as MMF here. And after that, the patient lost follow-up in this area. When the proteinuria around 2.5 grams and the creatinine around 2.5, 2.8, and the proteinuria around 1 gram to 1.5 gram. The patient after that lost follow-up. The picture of symptoms of systemic lupus, as was discussed before, skin hair, photosensitivity, butterfly rash, alopecia, pleuritic chest pain, pericarditis, heart murmurs, kidney inflammation, lupus nephritis, جوين بين ارثرالجي ارثرايتس منتال كوجنيتيف ديسفانكشن سايكوزس سيجر فيفر لانج بلوريتيك شيست بين نيمونيا بلوريتيس بلاد اميون كومبلكس بلاد كلوتس اند انيميا بولزز ماوس السر دونت فورجيت ابتزاز مالر فلاش ماوس السر فوتوفوبيا بلوريتيس بريكارديتيس بلوريزي لوبس نيفرايتس سكين راش جوينت بين ارثرالجيا راش وات ايفر دونت فورجيت ذيس مين توبكس كيس نمبر 2 31 years seen in clinic for proteinuria. So one of your colleagues, rheumatology, refers this patient for proteinuria for possible kidney biopsy. Patient already known systemic lupus more than 1 year and psoriasis. But before, no proteinuria, now start to pick up proteinuria. No alcohol, no tobacco, no drug abuse. Family history is positive for psoriasis, but not systemic lupus or kidney disease. Nothing, no history of allergy. Medication, because it's lupus more than 1 year now, this is Paconil. Paconil is hydroxychloroquine, 200 milligram BID, prednisone 5 milligram daily. It started 1 week prior to evaluation for joint pain. Other systemic review, just arthralgia and joint stiffening. Okay. Exam blood pressure 110 over 70, heart rate 70, afebrile body mass index 28. Patient looks appearing well and the cardiac lung examination remarkable. No peripheral edema, no joint synovitis, no new skin lesion, history of psoriasis, as we know. Creatinine 0.8 is stable, albumin 3 is okay, hemoglobin is 11, that's okay. N is too high, C3, C4 a little bit low, and double strand already borderline, and dismiss antral is negative, and hepatitis, HIV all negative. The main labs you can request for any patient with lupus or lupus nephritis, put this slide in your mind. For an analysis, a little bit concentrated, BH 5.5, plus 2 protein, no blood. Just plus 2 protein and no blood. No active urine sediment here. 2 white blood cells, 2 red blood cells. This is normal. Urine albumin creatinine ratio 1.5 gram, little bit not too high. Urine protein creatinine ratio 2.5 gram. Modest proteinuria. So kidney function already stable for this modest proteinuria and not nephritic range like other patient. 4.5 gram first case. Prior urine analysis at time of SLE, one just a plus one protein, now plus two, no blood, no white blood cells, no prior quantification. Case two kidney biopsy already done, just shows this picture. A little bit, it looks better, a little bit the proliferation of cells inside the capillaries and a little bit sickness of the glomerular base membrane. We'll come to this little bit also mesangial, a little bit mesangial and the proliferative cell already in the mesangium. Here, clearly, this sickness of glomerular basement membrane. This is a picture with silver stain. This picture of membranous nephropathy, like that. And with membranous, as we mentioned, M, you will find G, IgG deposition, the granular immunofluorescent deposition here. By electron microscope, what you will see here, just I put this cursor here for you. This is subepithelial deposition here. And this, look here, subepithelial. This is endothelial part of the capillaries. And this is a glomerular basement membrane, and this subepithelial, not subendothelial, will be inside. Subepithelial on the surface up here. This is a black deposition here. This that deposition, IgG deposition, in the subepithelial part of glomerular basement membrane. I think that's clear here. This subepithelial deposition also here, and damage of the podocytes. And that's more clear, little bit subendothelial here with subepithelial. But mainly subepithelial deposition, subepithelial deposition. He started the treatment for second case with RAS blockade, either Brindobrel, Remibrel, and Telmisartan, Candesartan, whatever you like, or available according to the economic status of your patient. Worsening systemic lupus symptoms, who with no improvement in proteinuria. What happened? Worsening systemic lupus with this patient, if you are treated by just a non-immunosuppressive therapy, started on CellCept, dose titrated up. This patient now started on CellCept, Myfortic, and titrated up, reach the target. When the patient here started CellCept, what is the ULO1? ULO1 proteinuria started to progress, and the albuminuria increase at that same time. This is the benefit of this urine protein will decrease and the serum albumin will be improved. The urine protein will decrease when we increase this MF, our target 2 to 3 grams per day. Just doing fine after that. And summary for case one, case two, case one young female, SLE 5 years, on antimalarial, Plaquenil, AKI 2.6, nephrotic proteinuria, hypertension, hypocomplementemia. and all renal pathologies are critical injury with lupus nephritis class 4 with active chronic picture. This just to remind you by patient number one, patient number two, young female, systemic lupus just 1 year, recent anti-malarial black meal, low dose prednisone, and normal renal function, subnephrotic proteinuria, hypocomplementemia, and lupus nephritis already class 5. In case number 2, this class 5 membranous type of lupus nephritis with no active lesion, less than 5% EFTA. 1,000 SLE patient in this trial, just 1,000 systemic lupus patient, 28% with lupus nephritis, 6.8% death. This is what means here in diagram. Patient with lupus nephritis around 88% will be survivor lower. Survivor will be lower with the patient with lupus nephritis, but survivor will be better with patient with no lupus nephritis, systemic lupus with or without lupus nephritis. If systemic lupus with lupus nephritis will be a low survival, and if a patient without lupus nephritis will be better survival. Outcome of a patient with lupus nephritis, premature death. What is outcome for any patient with lupus nephritis, premature death? Hazard ratio for this compared to non-lupus nephritis, as we mentioned before, 3.2 is too high. Hazard ratio for this compared to general population is 6. Before patient with lupus nephritis, with non-lupus nephritis, SLE without lupus nephritis, hazard ratio hazard risk of death in this patient around 3.2%. And the other patient with general population, 6 times more than general population. Don't forget that risk of this 6 times more general, more than general population. And this half of this 6 with the patient with lupus without lupus nephritis. Intestinal disease up to 30%, 30%. Don't forget this number. All this number will, you, anyone will ask you, or you can discuss with your patient. Has a risk of death in patient with lupus nephritis, systemic lupus around 6 times than general population. Risk of death with a patient with systemic lupus without lupus nephritis around 3.2% or 3%. Intestinal disease in patient with lupus nephritis around 30%, okay, within 10 years, within 10 years. Don't forget this 26-fold excess risk of death compared to general population also. Chronic morbidity like disease-induced damage, therapy-related complication, either from a disease. This chronic morbidity will come from where? Either from a disease-induced damage or therapy-related complication, cardiovascular, and depression. Lupus nephritis, class and outcome. You know here, this some patient with proliferative. Lupus nephritis, most aggressive and the worst prognosis. Pure lupus nephritis not associated with significant increased mortality. Pure membranous lupus nephritis, significant better renal survivor than the proliferative. In the stage renal disease, 10% at near between the proliferative and the pure membranous lupus nephritis. In the stage renal disease will be 10% at 10 years, but the proliferative is the most aggressive and the most worst type of lupus nephritis. When you are thinking to treat any patient with lupus, what is the aim of your treatment? Just prevention of intestinal disease and death by induction, remission of nephritis, prevent relapse, and minimize side effect of the therapy. What means by complete remission? Just complete remission means less than 0.5 gram per day proteinuria. Don't forget this. That's enough. And the creatinine return to his baseline. Issue, I think, I just should think what means by complete remission, partial remission, either creatinine and proteinuria, both together. Creatinine returned to his baseline and the proteinuria just less than 0.5 gram per day, Partial, just stabilization or improvement in hair creatinine, but not normal, and more than 50% decrease in proteinuria, but to less than 3 gram per day if nephrotic proteinuria adds a treatment initiation. This, I need you just don't forget this, complete and partial, complete and partial. Complete creatinine return to normal and the proteinuria less than 0.5 gram per day. What means by partial is stabilization or improvement in creatinine, but he will not return to normal and more than 50% decrease in proteinuria less than nephrotic range of proteinuria. That's enough for you. Besides clinical remission, regarding the clinical picture of your patient and the serological marker also. This is the definition of complete. That's enough for you to know. Relapse or flare, new development glomerular hematuria, cellular cast, red blood cell cast, picture or signs of relapse, it's active urine sediment. Active urine sediment is a sign of relapse, worsening renal function, recurrence, increase of proteinuria. This is another picture of relapse. If you see any one of this or all of this together, this the decision just to do kidney biopsy or no. If you have kidney biopsy and show this plus three or four before and the patient remission, and after that he relapse again by this picture, it's a treat again, treat by IV methylprednisolone, and you can give MMF high dose. But if the patient not responds, I can try cyclophosphamide. If not respond at that time, I will do kidney biopsy. Okay. This is my new trend now, and this is the last trend from the expert in this field more than 50 years now. If you will see patient with active urine sediment, worsening renal function, and recurrence or increased proteinuria, and this is patient already did kidney biopsy before and the remission before a long time, and she came again, either she stopped her medication or non-compliance and adherence, whatever, whatever. Patient came by this picture, you can treat aggressive like plus three or four. IV methylprednisolone, and second line will be MMF. If you saw improvement, that's okay. If no improvement, complete remission or partial remission, I will go, maybe I will go to cyclophosphamide after discuss risk with the family. And if no response after that, maybe I'll think kidney biopsy or no later. The kidney biopsy is the last option. Patient with class four, patient case number one, our case number one, this class four. As we mentioned before, AKI, creatinine 2.6, fibronoid necrosis, cellular crescent, as we saw in radium endocapillary hypercellularity, as we saw before, this severe proliferative lupus nephritis, this case number one we discussed today. How you can do this severe proliferative lupus nephritis induction therapy for 3 to 6 months, 3 to 6 months, 3 to 6 months by IV methylprednisolone, then I will, for 3 days, then prednisone 1 mg/kg. This will attenuate acute inflammation inside the kidney, and then will second line for suppress autoimmunity. I will start by MMF. Just so after that, the maintenance will slow tapering steroid and will modulate the immune system by MMF. Currently, I will use the MMF and monitor adverse effect for any medication. And this just progression and management of lupus nephritis from 1950 till 2012 till now. And this first started by low dose steroid with high risk of recurrence and relapse, whatever. And then started by NIH trial already in 1986. And started by this cycle of somide. And then till now, we started now just MMF versus azacitabrine. I think it's a whole trend now. Forward to just the prednisone, either pulse or maintenance with MMF or azacitabrine. This is the main bulk of therapy now, or main in management of cycle of lupus nephritis now. Again, this another studies to just the first line of therapy for proliferative, either MMF or IV cyclophosphamide plus steroid. The first line of therapy for any patient with proliferative GM, proliferative lupus nephritis, I will start the pulse steroids in maintenance, 1 mg/kg. In the second line, I will start MMF. If the disease not respond and more proteinuria, more AKI, more, I can give cyclophosphamide later. Otherwise, if still aggressive like that, I will proceed with kidney biopsy in future. NIH clinical trial, relatively severe lupus nephritis. Cyclophosphamide was better than a steroid monotherapy. Impossible to treat any lupus flare or active lupus, proliferative lupus with steroid alone. Steroid alone is okay to control the disease, but not will maintenance, will not be a good maintenance therapy for long run. You should add MMF or cyclophosphamide according to NIH regime. Cyclophosphamide bomb 5 to 1 gram monthly for 6 doses or 6 months. And continue steroid at that time, followed by maintenance therapy, either MMF or azacitabrine. This patient, just compare here, limitation with the cyclophosphamide therapy, just premature amenorrhea from infertility or infertility, infection, high risk of herpes zoster, and the high risk of this also. This is a problem with this is a problem with the cyclophosphamide. Infertility, infection, herpes zoster, and this need therapy with better safety profile and hopefully improve efficacy. So because this all side effect, all nephrologists, especially specialists in lupus nephritis and rheumatologists now, just cleaning away this cyclophosphamide by his side effect and started the main line of treatment now is MMF. MMF, because all this side effect from infertility, infection, herpes zoster, and this from this cyclophosphamide. Okay, urolupus, as we mentioned, urolupus nephritis trial between high dose and low dose. But for this trial, by Hosio et al., this patient, this trial, just low dose cyclophosphamide 500 IV every 2 weeks for 6 months or 8.5 grams for 6 months, monthly for 6 months. But this low dose already started azacioprine at that time. We're using azacioprine with least low dose of cyclophosphamide. In comparison, because in long run, you know, here this high dose will be more controlling the disease and free of failure or flare or relapse in comparison early with this. But in the late 5 years or 5 years later, this will be equal both. But in this study, this low dose group already with azacioprine, we don't know this is the effect of azacioprine with this low dose, but unfair to compare this low dose by high dose, and we'll come to this in our common mistakes later. MMF versus IV cyclophosphamide non-inferiority study. I think this study also 140 patients, 56% black, 17 is white, 20 has Hispanic, I think most of the nationality here, 16% type 3, 54 type 4, 19 type 5, membranous, 11 mixed, serum creatinine is around one, exclude already GFR less than 30, creatinine less for more than 3, MMF initial dose 500 BID, advanced dose increased to 1 gram, TID, cyclophosphamide bomb 5 to 1 gram monthly for 6 months, and severe infection occurred only with IV cyclophosphamide, diarrhea more frequent with MMF. I think here did a cycle of IV, a cycle of metal MMF. It looks here, MMF looks better than it's already done by Gensler et al. 2005. Okay. You look here, you will see here just the MMF better even with the IV, better than the IV cycle of somatic. If you have aggressive disease, don't be afraid. I need you to be relaxed and just start MMF gradually and increase the dose and wait. Don't be hurry to start a cycle of somatic because the all infection with cyclophosphamide. No risk of infection and infertility also with cyclophosphamide, okay? And this, I told you, all trend now with the MMF, not with the IV cyclophosphamide. And Spiriva already lupus management study also, Alam's study in 2009, just shows this patient responding to treatment. Just again, the MMF and the IV cyclophosphamide. As I mentioned, MMF is the orange one. I think the MMF is doing perfect as an IV cyclophosphamide. I think you know significant difference here. Why you lose toxic medication to our body, better to start by MMF. And here, as regard the adverse event, this already this. Comparing the IV cyclophosphamide in multiple trials here, the systematic review already shown this just the ovarian failure already with the IV cyclophosphamide, leukopenia, alopecia more with the IV cyclophosphamide, just only with the MMF, just only diarrhea is a common side effect. I think in comparison by this side effect in this systematic review, infertility with alopecia, leukopenia, pancytopenia, high risk of infection with IV cyclophosphamide, just to compare diarrhea with MMF, I will choose diarrhea and will be comfortable, will treat my patient, all my patient with lupus nephritis with the first line after steroid is MMF, not a cyclo, has no cyclophosphamide. MMF as a first line induction therapy for severe lupus nephritis, yes or no? Agree with me to use MMF as a first line of induction therapy for severe lupus. Just both yourself, you are a patient now, you or me as a patient of lupus nephritis, and you have these two medications. Cyclophosphamide is a toxic medication, will make you infertile, will make you pancytopenia, it will make you high risk of infection. And if you will end up by renal failure and you will go to kidney transplant, this will be another issue. for hemorrhagic cystitis or risk of malignancy, risk of more infection, risk of more pancytopenia will be trouble also with kidney transplant. I will go, for me, I will go, yes, I will go with MMF as a first line for induction therapy for severe lupus nephritis, especially if patient with estimated GFR less than 30. You know why? Because if you will give a cyclophosphamide one or two doses, and after that you will stuck by pancytopenia, you can't draw it again from body of your patient. Here from that point, if you will start the medication, you should continue. If you will start, I can't stop in the middle of the way. Better to leave on safe side, especially in our poor countries, just to start MMF, especially also if the estimated GFR less than 30. Respond equal to the MMF and cyclophosphamide and post hoc subgroup analysis of ALAMS was already responding where with estimated GFR improved more quickly in MMF group. MMF induced higher complete response and lower relapses than the IV cyclophosphamide at 12 months in crescentic lupus. Also in crescentic lupus is better than the IV cyclophosphamide. MMF achieved a higher complete response and had better side effect profile in class or lupus nephritis with necrotizing vasculopathy, higher complete response per side effect profile in class 4 lupus nephritis with necrotizing vasculopathy. So, yes, I will go with that. No, small, just a small retrospective studies suggest higher relapse rate, the risk of intestinal disease for MMF compared to IV cyclophosphamide severe lupus. But this is more retrospective. In ALAMS, there was a non-significant trend toward increased treatment failure in those who received MMF as induction therapy and MMF as a maintenance therapy. Long-term data are limited for that. Just most of the studies here, just LIGO, American College of Rheumatology, ULAR, all this, most of this, this is recommended as induction here, each one recommended induction and will go IV cyclophosphamide or MMF. Just give you a choice, either this or this. But I whatever studies will go, I will go to IV cyclophosphamide and then MMF. MMF versus cyclophosphamide is individualized according to race, ethnicity, prior cyclophosphamide exposure or no, desire for fertility preservation, and the cost, patient adherence. If your patient not adherence, what you will do? I will give cyclophosphamide at that point. Severity of the disease, no difference between both. Dose adjustment for weight and renal dysfunction, MMF, no need dose adjustment. Be aware, short follow-up duration MMF in trials, no hard endpoint in mini trials. What about the steroid therapy? No studies to guide dosing or tapering or duration. Just better to withdraw after 6 months to 1 year. Severe lupus nephritis IV missile burns, as I mentioned for you, from 250 to 1,000 milligram per day for 3 days. 1 milligram per kg per day, maximum 80, and the taper over 3 to 6 months. Don't forget this slide for listeroid. Okay? Taper for 3 to 6 months, at least 3 months. You start after that to taper your listeroid dose. Okay, this slide in your mind to start first line of treatment for your lupus nephritis with AKI, with severe active urine sediment, proteinuria, whatever. Just keep this slide in your phone and start your treatment. After that, you can review a presentation or guidelines or whatever you like. Just don't forget this supportive therapy or non-immunosuppressive therapy like ACE or ARBs. ACE or ARBs, as we mentioned before, whatever you like, available in your clinic or your center. Diuretic therapy for edema if your patient has massive edema. And it reads the blood pressure goal if less than 125 over 75. You have to keep your blood pressure under control by this ACE or ARBs. Antilipid antistatin. Management hypercoagulable state, especially if the albumin, serum albumin less than 20 or 25, you start prophylaxis anticoagulant, otherwise your patient will go to pulmonary DVT and pulmonary emphysema and sudden death. Osteoporosis, but don't forget this, any patient with membranous or any patient with severe lupus membranous nephritis, don't forget warfarin please, otherwise we have many patients died from pulmonary emphysema. Osteoporosis prevention from osteoporosis, vascular necrosis, just to give vitamin D and calcium carbonate. Primary and secondary prevention of cardiovascular disease, control this lipidemia and this hypertension, whatever, and anticoagulation, preservation of ovarian and testicular function, this banking already for fertility بانكينج تو بريزيرف ذيس فلويد انفكشن بروفلاكسز جي بي بكتيريا ماسيكلوبير وات ايفر اميونايزيشن نيموكوكا فاكسين بيفور ذيس اول اميون سبريشن اند بريجننسي كاونسل اند دونت فورجيت ذا بريجننسي كاونسل از ا ميستيك اوريدي ويل ديسكاس ليتر ان اور تيم ميستيكس. Don't forget anti-malarial. This is another mistake in our team mistakes. Anti-malarial hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine retard the renal damage and lower the frequency of class 4 lupus nephritis. Reduce the incidence of end-stage renal diseases. Anti-malarial benefit. What is the benefit of this hydroxychloroquine in our systemic lupus patient or lupus nephritis? This retard the renal damage and lower the frequency of class 4 lupus nephritis. Reduce the incidence of end-stage renal disease. Decrease lupus flare and thrombotic event. Should be used in all patients with lupus nephritis. Just before that, before you are using, just do fundus examination to check a retina. Refer the patient to your ophthalmology, dose and duration dependent, dose based on body weight, annual eye exam also. Maintenance therapy in proliferative lupus nephritis, cyclophosphamide should not be used. The maintenance therapy, MMF is the maestro here. If I will start MMF, just I will continue MMF. No need for cyclophosphamide at moment by new guidelines or by new experience since long years now from using this cytotoxic cyclophosphamide. MMF 1 to 2 grams per day is preferred as induction and maintenance therapy. If any contraindication or intolerable or any issue for this MMF, you can use the cheapest medication. Also effective medication as a cyobrine, 2 milligrams per kg per day, and just seek this PMT as we discussed before, activity, as otherwise you will do as a cyobrine toxicity and severe myelosuppression. See now if unable to tolerate MMF also, or as a cyobrine, I will go to tacrolimus or cyclosporin, and I better to start with tacrolimus. And keep your trough level 3 to 5. Duration of maintenance unknown, maybe 1 to 3 years, 1 to 5 years, 1 to 7 years, at least 3 years, but in your mind, at least 1 year. How I would treat the patient, how you would treat your patient, either you will give IV cyclophosphamide 500 to 1,000 milligram every month for 6 months, is in NIH protocol, plus IV methylprednisolone from 250 to 1 gram per day for 3 days, followed by prednisone 1 milligram per kg per day and the taper over 3 to 6 months, 4 to 6 months of remission, MMF 1 to 2 grams per day and the taper over prednisone. If no remission, keep the MMF 2 to 3 grams per day for 6 months and the daily prednisone. If remission, just taper the prednisone and keep the MMF 1 to 2 grams. If no remission, just think in now in rituximab or prednisone. Okay, just how you can treat now. If any patient with lupus flare, just you can go safely by this. If you all need to preserve your fertility of your patient, just go by this protocol. But I will not start IV cyclophosphamide. I will start from the start MMF and the gradual increase till highest dose, 3 grams per day. Don't forget this. To forget ACE or ARBs to control the blood pressure and the proteinuria, hydroxychloroquine, as I mentioned before, and the statin also, and the bacterium, acyclovir as a BGB and viral prophylaxis, calcium carbonate, vitamin D, osteoporosis. Don't forget PPI or H2 blocker if you have AKI as a IT prophylaxis. Don't forget the MISNA. MISNA is already medication just to protect from hemorrhagic cystitis, should be given before a dose of cyclophosphamide. We will give your patient a cyclophosphamide. Don't forget vaccination before immunosuppression like pneumococcal vaccine and also liberal lead, this for fertility and contraception. Don't forget all these adjuncts with therapy and prophylaxis, vaccines, fertility, and contraception, leuprolide. Don't forget all this when you are treating any patient with lupus nephritis, okay? This number two, pure membranous lupus nephritis here. Here, just as the cyclosporin, cyclophosphamide, and the prednisone alone, this is the lowest survival here. It account 14 to 20% of lupus nephritis patient, 10 to 20 with pure membranous lupus nephritis, 20-20%. Not really studies, only one randomized control trial, 42 patient, one pooled analysis, number 65, FDA and plus LMs. No difference between MMF and IV cyclophosphamide as we see. This cyclosporin here and the IV cyclophosphamide. وداتا سبورت يوز اوف اميونو سبريسيف ثيرابي ان بيشنت ويز سبنفريتك بروتينوريا اند نورمال رينال فانكشن. اوكي جاست دونت فورجيت باي ذيس اولسو تراي ذيس اوستينيتال جورنال امريكان سوسايتي اوف نفرولوجي 2009. This randomized control trial 42 patient, no difference between the MMF and IV cyclophosphamide. And even here, the cyclosporine and the IV cyclophosphamide, the prednisone, the prednisone, the lowest one in the survival or possibility of relapse. Also, cyclosporine is taking higher risk of relapse in comparison by the IV cyclophosphamide. And the possibility of remission will be better with the IV cyclophosphamide and cyclosporine, better than the prednisone. But the relapse will be better, lowest with the IV cyclophosphamide in comparison by cyclosporine here in this randomized control trial. Dual membranous lupus nephritis with nephritic range proteinuria or nephritic syndrome. MMF 2 to 3 gram daily or nephritic range proteinuria or nephritic syndrome. 3 gram daily for 6 months plus prednisone 0.5 milligram per kg for 6 months. 6 months, 6 months. This is your regimen if you have severe nephritic syndrome or nephritic angiopericytoria. Start MMF by highest dose, 3 milligram per day for 6 months. Prednisone 0.5 or 1 milligram for 6 months also. And you can taper later after 3 months. The patient to improve, just decrease the MMF to 1 to 2 gram daily or as a sovereign 2 milligram per kg per day. If not improved, I will go to cyclophosphamide and destroy it, and we'll see the response after that. How I would treat the case number two, this patient with membranous nephropathy, just giving non-immunosuppression and the malaria monitor for worsening of renal function or proteinuria. Is worsening, I will start MMF for her and pulse steroid again, monitor for class switch to proliferative lupus nephritis. This is the case number two in our discussion before. Just will go ahead by do introduction to systemic lupus. After that, I will go to our 10 mistakes in our management of any lupus nephritis. This is just a rapid summary, a rapid review. You can read from any book. This is basic. But my aim, الهدف بتاعي ان انا بركز على الكلينيكال بوينت وازاي تقدر تمانج العيال لما تتحط قدام العيال ازاي تقدر تعالج وتتابع العيان بتاعك ازاي. بس رابيد سامري او رابيد ريفيو للاس ال اي ذا اوتو ميون ديزيز ان نون ايتيولوجي. كلنا عارفين ان هو مرض مناعي ومش معروف السبب بتاعه، وبيشمل طبعا هو مرض اسمه الذئبه الحمراء، ده بيفترس الجسم بالكامل. السيرم اي ان اي شود بي بوزيتيف اند ذيس هول مارك اوف ذا ديزيز شود بي بوزيتيف ان موست اوف يور كيسز ويل كم تو ذا ريشيو ناو اند ذيس ذا هول مارك اوف يور ديزيز. اوكي is a multifaceted autoimmune disease characterized by production of pathogenic immunoglobulin as anti-nuclear antibody and phospholipid autoantibodies. The pathophysiology loss of immune tolerance to nuclear autoantigen, persistence autoreactive lymphocyte cell and nephritogenic antibody production. سيل ديز يعني من الاخر كده بيطلع انتي بوديز بتهاجم الخلايا بتاعت الجسم نفسه. ديبوزيشن اوف يو اند ليد تو انتيجين انتي بودي اميون كومبلكس ديبوزيتنج ذا جلومرولاي ليد تو كومبلمنت اكتيفيشن اميون سيل ريكروتمنت انفلاماتوري سايتوكاين برودكشن. اند ذس This is to summarize what will be happening. Most of our patient genetic already, we have this patient we discussed before in the cases in lupus nephritis, previous video, and we found her father already positive for lupus nephritis, and most of our patient cases today also with family history of lupus nephritis, genetic predisposition, and genetic risk factor is the first step in our disease, systemic lupus and lupus nephritis, genetic, any environmental triggers, and we'll come to that. This will stimulate our innate immune system activation. This will end by stimulating adaptive immune system activation. This will lead to antigen antibody and the immune complex deposition in the glomeruli and the clinical disease of onset. And this aberrant amplification of pathway increases resistance to therapy. And this will end by reversible tissue damage. This summarize our pathophysiology or pathogenesis of lupus nephritis, genetic, environmental risk factor or triggers, innate immunity start, adaptive immunity start, immune complex deposition, disease will start, resistance pathway and the damage in augmentation will increase, will lead to irreversible tissue damage. I think that's clear. This autoantigen and this dying lymphocytes, whatever, will go to a phagocytosis by DNA, and this will secrete this circulating genetic particles containing immune stimulatory nucleus to foreign bodies or virus infection. will stimulate another antibodies will attack our body. Okay. The end this will end by this immune complex deposition either subepithelial, subendothelial, and mesangial. Mesangial here, subepithelial here, subendothelial this. Okay. SLE can occur the teenage as we know from medical schools, primary affect women, especially in most cases we told in women at child bearing period. Female 9 to 1 already predominant, affect the black more than the white. Multiple susceptibility genes, as we mentioned before. Just don't forget major histocompatibility complex class 2, DR2, DR3, nasalamoctal MRCB, DR2, and DR3 with systemic lupus. Complement gene control C4, C2, C1Q, CH50. What is the trigger factor? Trigger فين هنا؟ قلنا فين في trigger هنا يا جماعه فاكرينها؟ الانفيرومنتال تريجر فاكتور ريسك فاكتور تو اكتيفيتد انيت اميونيتي تو الادابتيف اميونيتي تو الاميون كومبلكس از وي منشن بيفور. The sex hormone, ultraviolet, infection, INH, sulfonamide, penicillin. This will lead to disturb the lymphocytes, immune mechanism, and will start our cascade as we discussed before. Antibodies, autoantibodies may be directed to, and will end by this secretion autoantibodies. Autoantibodies, this will end to directed to nuclear component or cytoplasmic component or cell surface antigen. We'll come to that point. Systemic lupus diagnosis 4 to 11 criteria. But I guess to mention to review you malar rash, discoid rash, foot sensitivity, oral ulcer, arthritis, arthralgia, serositis, renal, lupus nephritis criteria with nephrotic range or nephrotic proteinuria, neurological manifestation, hematological pancytopenia, immunological, as we mentioned, ENE and anti-double strand and dismay syndrome and la and antiphospholipid syndrome. Okay, all this. And this SLICC criteria for systemic lupus, team point with positive ANA, this is called diagnosis systemic lupus. By this criteria already 2019, by arthritis and rheumatology, September 2019, this SLICC criteria for SLE team point from this, fever will take 2 points, another alopecia 2 points, oral ulcer, 2 points, subcutaneous discoid lupus 4 points, acute cutaneous lupus 6 points, synovitis 6 points, delirium or psychiatric, all this, and the cytopenia H1 will take a point. If you will calculate 10 points and the positive ANA, this will diagnose your systemic lupus. Lupus nephritis can be one of the first manifestation of SLE. Lupus nephritis can be one of the first manifestation. They will diagnose your SLE. Patient came by AKI, mild or moderate proteinuria, and maybe you need to diagnose your patient. You will the surprise this patient already. A full house under immunofluorescence and another criteria for systemic lupus. Hypertension is an important determinant factor in outcome also. The kidney, one of the major target organ, about 60% of adult SLE, 60% will develop lupus nephritis. 60% from SLE will develop lupus nephritis. The most lupus is the most common organ, threatening manifestation of SLE and continue to be result in significant morbidity and mortality, usually manifesting in the first 3 years of a disease activity. As I mentioned, 60% of SLE will develop lupus nephritis. Lupus nephritis is associated also with high morbidity and poor survival and poor outcome. The diagnosis and pathogenesis treatment of lupus nephritis are intricately linked together. The biopsy finding in lupus nephritis vary according to classification of lupus nephritis is essential for treatment decision. But if I have active urine sediment, proteinuria, and the AKI, whatever this means, proliferative gene, no other diagnosis, yeah? Lupus nephritis refers to inflammation. What means by lupus nephritis? Systemic lupus, as I told you, الزيبة الحمراء دي بتفترس أي عضو في الجسم. دي inflammation in the kidney, like inflammation in other organs. In patients with systemic lupus, ممكن يكون عندي بلوروسي, pericarditis, arthralgia, skin manifestation, all this inflammation. Patient with lupus nephritis may be present with asymptomatic proteinuria. معظم المرضى هيتحولوا لك من الروماتولوجي by proteinuria و asking for kidney biopsy. Nephrotic syndrome or severe kidney failure. Just proteinuria or acute kidney injuries is the main issue, if especially if we also we have this active urine sediment. And 5 to 20% will develop end-stage renal disease. 5 to 20% will end by end-stage disease. Around 30% will reach to end-stage renal disease and require dialysis or kidney transplant. And after kidney transplant, I see less than 10% recurrence. Diagnosis serum creatinine, EKI. Already I will do routine workup. I will found maybe you will found EKI. Urine I will found proteinuria, hematuria, red blood cells, dysmorphic or red blood cell cast. C3C4 is low, anti double strand is high, AN is high. Kidney biopsy will give you multiple five class or six class, and we'll come to that later. Treatment, as I told you, induction phase, maintenance phase. Don't forget any patient you suspect low pulse or autoimmune, start pulse steroid. Pulse steroids in maintenance steroid 1 milligram per kg. If your diagnosis all with serological and the clinical and everything with lupus nephritis, just start empirical MMF. MMF, small dose and titrate up. And if still no response, just you will think cyclophosphamide or biopsy this and according to your case, response after that. As we know, this lupus nephritis and primer, this from Twitter, this I found this classification is nice classification to remind us by all the six class. Class one, class two, four to six. Class one, minimal mesangial. Class two, mesangial proliferative. Class three, focal proliferative. Class four, diffuse proliferative. Class five, membranous lupus nephritis. Class six, advanced sclerosis lupus nephritis. And they will come to each one. And just with each one by diagram now, and don't forget this management I just summarized here if you like to read later. And this again, six class already, sclerosis here, and this diffuse proliferative, focal proliferative, and this minimal mesangial like normal, mesangial proliferative, mesangial expansion with proliferation, and this pure membranous by silver stain sickness of glomerular base membrane. Don't forget, we can classify also glomerular immune deposition systemic lupus according to percent of global glomerulosclerosis of more than 90% diffuse sclerosing globus nephritis class 4. If less than this global sclerosis more than 90% diffuse sclerosing globus nephritis class 6. Finish. Out. If the sclerosis is at 90%, local location of immune deposit, either mesangial, subendothelial, or intramembranous, this is membranous lupus nephritis. If subepithelial and intramembranous, subepithelial, intramembranous, like we saw in the second case already, this is membranous lupus nephritis class 4. We saw subepithelial already and intramembranous, okay? Intramembranous deposition, this is pure. Our second case we discussed before, this under this category. If mesangial, just mesangial cellularity present or no. If no mesangial cellularity, this means minimal mesangial lupus nephritis class 1. If mesangial cellularity, yani mesangial expansion with proliferation of the cell, this mesangial proliferative class 2. Subendothelial deposition, if this immune complex deposition already in subendothelial, if less than 50% focal lupus nephritis class 3, if more than 50% diffuse, lupus nephritis class 4. Okay, I think that's a very nice diagram also. This cartoon just show clinical pathological classification class 1 mesangial here expansion and this mesangial proliferation. Just mesangial, this is the red one, mesangium, and this is the cells here, proliferation of the expansion of the mesangial and the cell proliferation. Class 3 and the 4, just mesangial proliferation and the cell proliferation. Subendothelial here, this is endothelial. Inside the capillary here, this endothelial inside and the epithelial outside, this is epithelial cells, blue sides. And the class 5, the sub-epithelial, epithelial above the membrane outside, under the podocytes, this sub-epithelial, this is class 4. Class 3 and 4 plus 5, you'll find sub-epithelial, sub-endothelial, and the mesangial expansion all together. Class 3 and 4, just the sub-endothelial deposition, mesangial expansion, this is class 3 and 4. And this again, another classification. You remember this 1995 WHO classification. No need to mention this normal glomeruli, pure mesangial. The third one is focal, fourth one diffuse membranous, advanced sclerosing. And this came 2003, ISN, International Society of Nephrology or Renal Pathology Society, classification of lupus nephritis. Class 1, class 2, class 3, 4, class 5, and the class 6, as will come later. As we mentioned this also, and mentioned already this, class 1, class 2, 3, class 4, we'll already mention that. And this full house already, immunofluorescence. In case of diffuse lupus nephritis, you will find, just don't forget, the amide, IgM, and G, and A, and maybe IgD also, C3, C1Q. This is the main jam. جامد انا فاكر من الكيمستري كنا بنسموها جامد جامد اللي هو اي جي جي اند اي اند ام فور دي 3، بحط عليهم سي 3 والسي 1 كيو، بقى اي جي ام اي جي جي اي جي اي سي 3 سي 1 كيو. ذس مينز فول هاوس اوف ديفيوز لوبس نفرايتس كلاس 1 ازوميشن مينيمال ميزانجل اكسبانشن از ويل سي. ذس مينيمال ميزانجل هير، ميزانجل 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 اكسبانشن اوف ذس كلاس 1. You will see mesangial expansion with proliferation inside. So, one moment, I will open light. كلاس 2 زي ما انت شايف هنا في الصوره عندنا، بتلاقي اللي هو الميزانجل اكسبانشن مع السيل بروليفريشن. طبعا بتلاقي في سيل بروليفريشن هنا، المفروض معناها هي لما تقول الميزانجل بروليفريتيف المفروض شفت 3 سيلز ان 1 رو، 3 سيلز ان 1 رو، 3 سيلز 3 سيلز ان 1 رو، اند ذيس ميزانجل بروتينيشس ماتيريال ذيس 1 ذيس ميزانجل هير ذيس ميزانجل اند ذيس سيل بروليفريشن ذيس نيمد ميزانجو بروليفريتيف اكسبانشن. اوكي، and this mesangial proliferative mesangial here mesangial expansion with cell proliferation. بتلاقي هنا البروتينيشس ماتيريال او الميزانجل هي اكسباندد هنا ومالتيبل سيلز هنا، دي ميزانجو بروليفريتيف. ذيس تيبيكال بيكتشر، دونت فورجيت ذيس، دونت فورجيت ذات. اند ذيس اجين ميزانجو بروليفريتيف، انذر ميمبرين بروليفريتيف بيكوز الميمبرين از سكند هير، جلومر بيز ميمبرين سكند 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 وذ ذيس ميزانجل اكسبانشن اند بروليفريشن ذيس ميمبرين ديفرنشيت بتوين ميزان. هنا الجلومر بيز ميمبرين از اوكي از لوكس نورمال، بات هير الجلومر بيز ميمبرين ان كومباريزون باي ذيس ذا بيكتشر اوف ميمبرينس ميمبرينو ميمبرينس لوبس نفرايتس. اوكي، ذيس ميمبرينو بروليفريتيف برضه الجلومر بيز ميمبرين سكند وذ ديفيوز بروليفريشن ميمبرينو بروليفريتيف جلومر membranous lupus nephritis but this membrano proliferative lupus nephritis also and the diffuse proliferative lupus nephritis diffuse she shows this diffuse proliferative lupus nephritis shows immunofluorescence microscopy massive lumpy humby deposition of IgG. This lumpy humby lumpy humby lumpy humby deposition of IgG. دايما خليك فاكر membranous M مع G IgG دايما deposition هنا lumpy humby deposition here. What you will see here is normal glomerulus already, glomerulus membrane and the podocyte is normal, food excess already is okay. This is the capillaries and this platelet, white blood cells, red blood cells, whatever. This is the endothelial cells here inside and this is the epithelial cell podocyte. This is a normal picture. But here you will see sub-endothelial deposition here. This is and the tubular reticular inclusion here. The characteristics of systemic lobus. This is already here, and we see tubular reticular inclusion or structure in the lupus nephritis. This is a picture here, subendothelial deposition here also. And just in IH, lupus nephritis activity and the chronicity incidence, activity, endocapillary hypercellularity, neutrophils, and the fibroid necrosis, crescent, collidiate hypothetical activity, endocapillary, endocelial hypercellularity or position, neutrophils, fibroid necrosis, crescent, this activity also. A wire loop, Hellens rhombi, interstitial inflammation, as we saw in the first case. And the chronicity will found global glomerulosclerosis, fibronoid crescent, interstitial fibrosis, tubular atrophy. This is what means by segmental or global. Either global means كل الكابيلاري او الجلومرولاي، segmental just only من الجلومرولاي، تمام؟ يبقى segmental جزء من الجلومرولاي، global كل الجلومرولاي متغطين. فوكال اور ديفيوز، فوكال ده جاست يعني سمول نمبر، لو عندك 10 جلومرولاي منهم خمسه بس اللي معمولين، لو ديفيوز عندك ال 10 جلومرولاي كلهم افكتد مور ذان 80% ليس ذان 50%. فوكال سيجمنتال، فوكال اند سيجمنتال كذا جلومرولاي بس سيجمنت من جلومرولاي، فوكال جلوبال جزء من الجلومرولاي بس كل الجلومرولاي اللي افكتد توتالي افكتد جلوبال يا. And this diffuse is segmental, diffuse segmental يعني كل الجلومرولاي بس كل الجلومرولاي متاخد منها جزء، كل دايره متاخد منها جزء. هنا ديفيوز كل دايره مثلا بجلومرولاي. عندك ديفيوز كل الدايره عندنا كلها خلاص اتفرد في الموضوع اكتر من مور ذان 80% بيقول لك 100% سكلروزس. This means this is a picture we'll see under microscope. Especially patient with anti-GBM. Active lesion of lupus nephritis, mesangial hypercellularity, as we saw, this is a mesangial with cells here. This means a mesangial hypercellularity. This was hyaline material, we'll see like this picture, this means hyaline lesions already. ميزانجل يعني الماسيف ميزانجل اكسبانشن هي فايبرونويد نيكروزيس اف يو سي ذا بيكتشر اوريدي اند ذيس جلوبال سكلروز هير جلوميرولايزز جلوبال سكلروز جلوبال سكلروز ذيس كلاس 6 لوبس نيترايتس اكتيف ليجنز كريس انفورميشن اف يو سي ذا بيكتشر هير ذي ستارت تو بي هاي لاينز فايبروكلينر كريسنت اور مينلي سيلولر كريسنت هير ستارتد ذيس فايبرس كريسنت اوريدي كلير هير And this, as we mentioned, class 3, this focal lobus nephritis, focal proliferative lobus nephritis. These are focal global or focal segmental, as we mentioned before. Less than 50% of the glomeruli, focal segmental or focal global, okay? This class 3. Now class 3, active or chronic. Active such as lesion, either active or chronic lesion. If look, class 3A, class 3AC, class 3C. Class 3C is a chronic lesion already. This is another class 3 with proliferative GN. You will find part of the glomeruli, not all the glomeruli. This part just focal glomerulobus nephritis, focal lobus nephritis, just focal part with mesangial proliferative changes. And this class 4 either diffuse, global or diffuse, segmental, more than 50% of the glomeruli. And the class 4 either diffuse segmental, active, global, active, segmental, active, or chronic. يعني segmental, global, either active, active, or active, chronic, active, chronic, or chronic, chronic. تمام. This class 4 طبعا with diffuse, diffuse all the glomeruli now with the diffuse mesangial proliferation and this membranous lobus nephritis and the primary membranous looks alike. This membranous lobus nephritis with this primary membranous looks alike at the comparison. And this class 4 already was used diffuse mesangial proliferation. And this class 5 membranous, typical silver stain with thickness of the glomerulus membrane. This clear already for all of us. This again another membranous lobus nephritis with diffuse thickness of the glomerulus membrane here and everywhere. And this is just magnification of the of this silver stain. We saw this already spikes here of subepithelial deposition. This is a typical picture of membranous lobus nephritis or regular membranous, usual membranous GN. Again, the thickness of the glomerulus membrane, another one with the spikes here. We saw podocytes like spikes and there by this silver stain and thickness of the glomerulus membrane. This was membranous lobus nephritis. This typical electron microscope for membranous subepithelial. We have this endothelial side and this glomerulus membrane and this epithelial part, this deposition here, this subepithelial. And again, here, what we will see here, this mesangial area, this mesangial expansion also here, this mesangial here, and this also mesangial expansion. And differentiate between membranous lobus nephritis and the usual membranous by full house. If you will found IgG, IgM, GA, and C3C1Q, this is a picture of membranous lobus nephritis, not simple, just a regular or simple membranous or primary membranous. This just will come by IgG only, but not full house. Full house with pattern of membranous lobus nephritis. This granular IgG immunofluorescence is a picture of membranous nephropathy. A kidney biopsy, how to diagnose? Just you need kidney biopsy, but if you have clinical and serological active picture of lobus nephritis with strong family history, don't be hard for kidney biopsy. Kidney biopsy later, we can do that. And this activity and the coronosity, as we mentioned, depending on mesangial proliferation, hyaline, cellular crescent, necrosis, neutrophils, interstitial inflammation, this activity in this. According to the scores by, you can read that already. And this should become by histopathology already for that. You can read if you need to know. Chronicity, as we mentioned before, how many glomeruli sclerosis, fibrous crescent, trophic tubules, interstitial fibrosis, all this chronicity index, you should calculate the risk. And this again, just the explanation all the above. Antiphospholipid, any patient with lobus nephritis, just don't forget to send them anticardiolipin, lobus anticoagulant, and the beta 2 and the glycoprotein, all the lobus antibodies work up. Check the PT also may be prolonged. A picture of suspected antiphospholipid syndrome, as we discussed in one case in our previous video. Last case, I think, will come by vascular occlusion, arterial and venous thrombosis, repeated miscarriage from the history. Should take all this history in the patient with systemic lobus for preparation for kidney transplant. ask him DVT, pulmonary embolism, any clots anywhere in your dialysis line, how many lines change, how many fistula clotted, a repeated miscarriage, you are pregnant before, how many miscarriage, focal neurological deficit, you have TIA, CVA before or no, livedo reticulation examination, any endocarditis before, serum cytopenia, comb test, hemolysis, may stimulate also HUS. Also take care from that point in your examination. A useful marker to diagnose just line, T double strand, DCR complement, all this issue the same. And in a sensitive test, more than 80% should be, the non-specific less than 5% will be negative, but more than 80% should be positive. This is a pathognomic for SLA with the complement and the double strand DNA. Don't forget this anti-histone antibody if you suspect drug induced, if the drug history, small nuclear SNRNB also, mixed connective tissue disease will be positive also with LOBUS and ROANTELA, for neonatal LEOBUS if you plan for pregnancy, and ribosomal B also, psychiatric disease, phospholipase and antiphospholipid syndrome, and drug induced systemic LOBUS, LOBUS-like syndrome, positive ENE, ulceritis, serositis, cutaneous feature, renal and CNS unusual, hydralazine, bruconamides is a major two medication. Therapeutic goals, when you are thinking to treat any LOBUS patient, what's your goal to achieve complete renal remission? Need to maintain or make your kidney safe hand, avoid any renal flare, avoid any chronic renal impairment or end-stage renal disease, to fulfill this objective with minimal toxicity of side effect of your medication. Don't forget general treatment approach, there's some protection, smoking cessation is most important, avoid immunization during the immunosuppression, especially with live vaccines, avoid radiation therapy, avoid any specific medication like salva and penicillin, estrogen, pregnancy and contraception, don't forget this part in when you are treating a childbearing female. In general management of any lupus nephritis, either non-immunosuppressive therapy or immunosuppressive therapy, don't forget these two main part of your treatment. Don't forget this adjunct when therapy or non-immunosuppressive therapy, ACE or ARB is diuretic, blood pressure control, anti-lipid therapy, VT prophylaxis, severe hypoalbuminemia, osteoporosis prophylaxis, and the primary and secondary prevention cardiovascular, don't forget the cardiovascular disease, ovarian and testicular function, fertility banking, don't forget the infertility part, infection part, prophylaxis, immunization before, pregnancy counseling, anti-malarial therapy, as we mentioned before, hydroxychloroquine, this will decrease or retard the renal damage, low frequency, lower the frequency of class 4 lupus nephritis, reduce the incidence of end-stage disease, decrease lupus flare and thrombotic event, should be used in all patients with lupus nephritis. Just before using hydroxychloroquine, you should send your patient to ophthalmology to check your retinal, otherwise your DMU, you are the cause of hair blindness or retinal detachment or retinal problem. There was annual eye exam after that. Don't forget in your thinking or in facing any patient with lupus nephritis or refer to you for nephritic range or active urine sediments, the first line, methylprednisolone IV. If the patient can't tolerate oral band, you also you can start oral 1 milligram per kg direct, yeah. But if the patient can't tolerate vomiting like that, or came by generalized edema, like our case presentation, last first case presented in last videos, flare patient, just you start IV methylprednisolone until the patient stabilize, and second line will be MMF. And no indication for kidney biopsy if you diagnose clear by clinical and serological in front of your eye and the biopsy will not add or change your management plan. And the maintenance therapy, as we mentioned, MMF or azacioprine as a maintenance therapy. What is the goal of immunosuppression? Why I will give this induction therapy by steroid? The goal of immunosuppression therapy is the resolution of inflammatory and immunological activity with achievement of complete response, the initial induction phase. The goal of this approach is to minimize early damage and to preserve long-term kidney health. As I told you, induction and the maintenance therapy, induction for 3 to 6 months, either steroid, MMF, and cyclosamide, the third line, maintenance at, by either MMF, azacioprine, and the prednisone. Second line cycle, calcium urine inhibitor, rituximab, this is on your mind also. And the new approach will come to multi-drug therapy MMF with CNI, with newer agents like voclosporin and obinutuzumab, blimumab also, all this ongoing now and the result will be soon. اس لي مانجمنت ويز امبروف ثيرابيوتيك موداليتيز 10 يير سرفايفر ناو ريتش اباف 80% ايرلي تريتمنت از مانداتوري مين كوز اوف ذس مين كوز اوف ذس مين كوز اوف ذس كارديوفاسكولار اند انفكشن فاكتورز ليدنج تو كورونار ديزيز ثيرويد هايبرتنشن ديسليبيديميا هايبر كوجولابيلتي اند فاسكولايتس اول ذس كان ليد تو كورونار ديزيز ثيرويد هايبرتنشن ديسليبيديميا هايبر كوجولابيلتي اند فاسكولايتس Treatment of nephritis may not require initial biopsy. If you have clear serological and clinical, please, please, please start your management and see response later. And if you need kidney biopsy, you can arrange later. If you not start second line like MMF or just only started prednisolone and you are hesitant to start immunosuppression, just do go ahead with kidney biopsy. Biopsy would be indicated if failure of improvement of renal function or reduction of proteinuria with a follow-up to reduce the immunosuppression and document the coronicity. If you suspect your patient no response with progression of CKD, document this patient already fibrosed and kidneys, kidneys fibrosed. Oral prednisone as a pregnancy, what is the safe medication as a maintenance medication or a management in patient with pregnancy with lupus nephritis or systemic lupus, just oral prednisone. And as a cyproprine is the main safe medication. Maintenance therapy has to 1 year to 3 years, 7 years according to your patient response. Patient with risk of progression continue on indefinite and we don't know that's the patient with risk of progression or relapse. Tapering immunosuppression should be slow over 6 to 1 years, 6 months to 1 years. After that you can start tapering. Outcome standard therapy remission may be reached 50% over 6 months, relapse at 5 years around 50%. And don't forget this when you are treating any patient with lupus nephritis, other comorbidities like cardiovascular and the CKD dilemma and infectious prophylaxis, cardiovascular and the fertility and the osteoporosis. Don't forget all this as adjunct from linked therapy with our treatment for lupus nephritis. KDIGO guidelines, as we mentioned, just you know already this KDIGO 2021 NGN. I will start by this CKD definition with this stage of CKD and albuminuria. You all know that already. Don't forget more than 3 months with estimated GFR less than 60 or already with no recovery of kidney more than 3 months. This is diagnosed as a CKD. And this albumin creatinine ratio is the most important for me, milligram per millimole less than 3, 3 to 30, more than 30, is a severe increased proteinuria. Now this from micro and macro increased to moderately increased, severely increased. And if you take milligram per gram, this is less than 30, 30 to 300. More than 300, most of modest or moderately increased the proteinuria, just will creatinine will be normal. Creatinine will be normal in that. They will be not changed. Maybe if the patient came by severe proteinuria, he will be started AKI like that. And this is general principle and management of GN disease in general, what is indication for kidney biopsy. And dietary and management of GN, if you like to read, just don't forget sodium restriction, less than 2 grams per day, is equal 90 millimole per day. And that restriction of protein, as we know already, 0.8 to 1 gram per kg per day. And you can read more if you like. And this already in KDIGO 2021. And this is lupus nephritis, if patient with systemic lupus erythematosus. And testing indicated that systemic lupus SLE presenting with suspicion of SLE. There, what is that lab you will do? Just serum creatinine, urine and the dipstick and urine analysis microscopy, protein creatinine ratio, bone creatinine ratio, and the serology in the end, the complement and double strand. All this will be done. And you can go ahead and in summary, for this patient, if there is any evidence of abnormal proteinuria or urine sediment, abnormal proteinuria assessed by dipstick, protein more than plus 2, and or PCR more than 500 milligram, with or without active urine sediment, dysmorphic red blood cells, or red blood cell cast, or whatever. If no further urine testing is needed, if yes, I will go to 24-hour urine proteinuria of more than 500. I will consider biopsy. If repeated testing is no, just will follow up and observe and maybe I will start an immunosuppressive therapy here. But now, before this biopsy, as clinical practice, most expert now, more than 50 years in the management of lupus nephritis, if you will see all this picture, don't go to kidney biopsy, start your management and see response. And if no response, buy prednisone and second line like MMF. You don't, if you will start only prednisone, go to kidney biopsy. If you will start prednisone and MMF, no benefit for kidney biopsy at the moment. Just give and follow your patient with regard to serology, immunology, and the proteinuria will take long time and will come to that point later. And this another general management for patient with lupus nephritis. As we mentioned before, cardiovascular risk, proteinuria, and infection risk, bone prophylaxis, ultraviolet light exposure, infertility, and planned pregnancy, and the cancer. All this should be discussed with your patient. And this again, this I think it is the tapering initial therapy with active lupus. With the regime, now you can taper lysergide. And how can I start your management? And this approach to immunosuppressive therapy with patient class 1 and the class 2, if patient low-level proteinuria, immunosuppressive treatment guided only by extrarenal manifestation, no need. And if nephrotic syndrome, evaluate for lupus podocytopathy, treat minimally changed disease just with the prednisone and immunosuppressive therapy. And if kidney biopsy shown, it's again class 3 and the class 4. We recommend patient with active class 3 and the class 4 with or without membranous should be treated initially by a glucocorticoid, the pulse either low dose or intravenous, and the cyclophosphamide. This 1B recommendation. We recommend also, this is the guidelines, they recommend also to, after completion initial therapy, patient should be placed on another maintenance therapy like MMF and or azathioprine already, mycophenolic acid or azathioprine. But no one follows these guidelines now because any patient with proliferative GAN will start direct for him MMF with prednisone after IV methylprednisone. Will give direct MMF as a first line and we'll see response. Okay. Again, as a maintenance therapy, I will continue MMF for azathioprine and slow tapering the steroid after 6 months to 1 year. And this is just already maintenance therapy for proliferative GAN. This is by Alam's maintenance trials, maintenance nephritis trials. This two trials show this steroid and the azathioprine MMF. And again, here, the difference between MMF and azathioprine. I think the effect is not so much a difference, but already the MMF is a survival free relapse better with the MMF than the azathioprine in this Alam's maintenance trial. But this maintenance nephritis trial already, I think no significant difference or little bit difference already. And this you can read, I mean, I will not lose time here. This is a complete remission, as I mentioned before, or partial remission, complete remission reduction proteinuria less than 0.5 gram per day, and the stabilization or no improvement in kidney function, plus or minus 10% or 15% of the baseline within 6 to 12 months of starting the therapy. بعد 6 شهور أو سنة من starting the therapy, we will really define this as a complete remission, partial remission, reduction in proteinuria by at least 50% or proteinuria less than 3 gram. Nephrotic range proteinuria and stabilization improvement in kidney function, and not all baseline, but around also 15% of baseline within 6 to 12 months. No kidney response failure to achieve partial or complete remission within 6 to 12 months of starting therapy. At that time, you can, you think after 6 months, you can think you to start cyclophosphamide or whatever, or kidney biopsy again, whatever you will do. Class 5 already, just a flow nephrotic range proteinuria. But if nephrotic syndrome, I will start by immunosuppression, especially MMF with steroid and hydroxychloroquine. If low subnephrotic range of proteinuria, just non-immunosuppressive medication. If no response, we'll start prednisone at that point, and we'll come to that point later. Management, patient, if patient non-adherence is a big problem. If you cannot respond, please don't forget the adherence or no, or patient relapse or whatever. After complete or partial remission has been achieved, lupus nephritis relapse should be treated with the same initial use the therapy for original response or alternative recommended first line therapy. Just use the same and check your adherence for your patient because most of our patients not adherence to medication. And we'll come to that point later. Lupus nephritis and thrombotic microangiopathy, you can resist later also. Pregnancy and patient with lupus nephritis will come to that point also. This activity index as we mentioned before. And this updates on lupus nephritis core curriculum. I advise everyone to read this core curriculum 2020, 2020, lupus nephritis. That will give you just a patient, a systemic lupus patient who is newly diagnosed with proteinuria already referred to you, proteinuria 500 and active urine sediment from the small red blood cells, the red blood cell cast and the white blood cell cast, whatever, and the decrease in kidney function with AKI. If this patient should perform, if the patient with all this criteria came to you, you can start your management, what, no problem, and you can also perform a kidney biopsy as you like. But I think the kidney biopsy if you will start, the prednisone and PMF, no benefit from kidney biopsy. We will not guide you, will not give you any more updates. And just according to the finding, you will classify your patient. The treatment according to subnephritic or nephritic range opportunity. I think this is a good protocol also. Don't forget hydroxychloroquine and immunosuppression, as we mentioned. I need you to mention to fix in your mind what immunosuppression, pulse steroid, and will continue prednisone 1 milligram per kg for 6 months, and then you can taper later, okay? And this means immunosuppression medication. Hydroxychloroquine, I will start after examining my retina by ophthalmology to clear from hydroxychloroquine side. And they will give another blood pressure control, dyslipidemia, anticoagulant prophylaxis. As we mean, this is a summary of all this dilemma, what I need you to understand from all this dilemma of lupus nephritis, okay? Our patient with nephrotic syndrome, hydroxychloroquine, kidney protective therapy, and immunosuppressive therapies, as you mentioned, MMF or calcineurin, cyclophosphamide, no one using now, little use, and the maintenance you can use also as a sabrine if pregnancy like that. And this is the same. You can take this approach for treatment class 4 from this updates in core curriculum 2020, okay? American Journal of Kidney Disease, updates of lupus nephritis, core curriculum 2020. Tamam, Jamil? And this class 3 and 4, you can read also what is the dose we'll use as an induction and what is the medication MMF here, but it's the first line here for 6 months. And you will see, and you can taper later if your patient is stable. And the second line is our BO. We are using also BO cyclophosphamide and some using IV cyclophosphamide, but don't forget the side effect of all disease. And if the patient refractory, we can go to multi-target therapy and rituximab, IVIG, leflunomide, and voclosporin or bamilumab or whatever. Any new medication will come in the future. We'll discuss that later. Immunosuppressive treatment class 3 and class 4, all mentioned here. You can read from the guidelines. And this again, just a complete response, partial response. I told you before, I will not confuse you now. What is the indication of immunosuppression in lupus nephritis? Proliferative lupus nephritis, high risk of aggressive disease. All patients with diffuse proliferative, most patients with focal proliferative, membranous lupus nephritis. Treatment again is proliferative component also. We can use that. Risk factor for progression, either elevated creatinine, hypertension, proteinuria, anemia, plaque, Hispanic, interstitial disease, EFTA, cellular crescent, all this will worsen your prognosis and progress your disease. After initiate your therapy, frequency and severity of relapse, complete or partial remission, severity of azotemia, all this also a risk factor for progression of your disease. You'll see your patient with high creatinine, hypertension, nephrotic range of proteinuria, anemia, plaque, EFTA, cellular crescent, the frequency of relapse, complete or partial remission, or partial remission or severe AKI, all this risk factor for progression of your disease. And again, this same risk factor, but I don't know the slide not clear here. The same previous one. Predictive of remission is a low chronicity index or renal biopsy, white race, low baseline proteinuria, low serum creatinine, or male gender, earlier development of nephritis, whatever. Resistance to lupus nephritis, we'll come to this later. We can use rituximab or anti-B-cell antibodies, and we'll come to this bilirubin also, bind to the lymphocyte stimulator, and the BLYS, we'll come to this later also. future and this picture just of algorithmic inhibition with refractory lupus nephritis, what you will do step by step. And this sampling of the current active lupus nephritis trial for this refractory and other monoclonal antibodies like obinutuzumab, imumab, rituximab, all this and the voclosporin already. All this will be used in near future, all PSL targeted therapy, either anti CD20, rituximab, or obinutuzumab, or an anti PLYS, belimumab, and the protease inhibitor, also proteasome already. Also, obinutuzumab like rituximab anti CD20, and we'll come to discuss obinutuzumab also in refractory lupus using another trial. This is a picture of systemic lupus, and we'll come now to 10 mistakes in management of lupus nephritis. We'll take a rest of 5 minutes, and maybe I will present in another part two better to be clear for each one. And we can stop here. We can start this presentation later. Okay, thank you so much. وأنا أسألكم الدعوة بالتوفيق والسداد وانتظرونا في البارت 2 until we finish our